Hey, what's up, everyone? So I got some feedback on creating a more in-depth guide on creating dynamic backgrounds using Typebot callbacks. So what I'd like to do in this video is to walk you through just step by step on how to set it up on your end, and then call out some little nuances that you should be aware of. So first thing that you want to do is head over to this web page that I shared in the post here. And scroll down, and under helpful links, you'll notice a few different links. And here, what we're going to do is first set up our Typebot flow, our Google Sheet, and then replicate the code from this GitHub repo. So let's go ahead and open up Typebot flow here. And what's going to happen is that I get pointed to my account, right? Because I'm already logged in. But for you, you're going to see something slightly different. In your case, you're going to see this duplicate button up here. So go ahead and duplicate it into your account. And then next, we'll set up the Google Sheet. So in the blog post that I shared, you'll see this Google Sheet template link. Let's go ahead and open it up. And then once it's open, head over to File and make a copy and save it into your drive. All right, great. So the next thing that we want to do is set up the source code. So let's go over to the GitHub repo link. And then here, there's a few different ways to copy the code. You can go directly to the file. So if we go to the image example, you can just go straight into here and start to download the raw files like you see right here. Or what you can do is head over to the main repository up here, and then under code, you can download as a zip file. And then the last way, and my personal favorite way to do it, is just easier, I think. If you know a little bit of Git, you can just copy this link, open your terminal, and then from here you can enter git clone and then pass in the link, and it'll copy the entire repository into whatever directory that you're in. All right, so now I'm in the Visual Studio Code Editor, and you'll notice that when I cloned that repository, it created this structure, or it brought in everything, right? So it brought in this folder for dynamic background callbacks, and then within that folder have two subfolders, an image example and then a video example. So for this first pass, let's go ahead and go through the image example just because it's a little bit more nuanced than the video example. So first, head over to the index.html file, and you'll notice that there are different sections to this file, and everything is contained in this index file. And what I mean by that is that all the styling and all of the JavaScript is in here. It's not in a different file. Everything is in here. So here under the style tag, you can see all of the Ken Burns effects that I'm using. And then down below, the main, really, it's super simple. The main body of the web page is this background image. And you can see that it's bringing in this BG file that looks like this. And then down below is where you can find the script. And this is where most of the action is taking place, right? The script is kind of divided into two different sections. There's this main section here, and this is pretty much in charge of changing the image animation and transitions. And if you want a little bit more information, you can read the comments that are listed down here just to get a better sense of what's happening. And then down below is where the callbacks are taking place from Typebot. So what you'll want to do is to bring in your Typebot ID. So you can see here's my Typebot ID. And to get yours, what you need to do is head over to your Typebot account and then head over to Share and copy this ID. Next, what you want to do is insert whatever variables that you want. And something that I corrected, and this is all thanks to your guys' feedback, is I actually brought in the wrong variable here. So I made a change to the Typebot and forgot to update the variable name here. So thanks for calling that out. I went ahead and updated the changes to the repo, so it should be all good. If you're having a look at this video right now. Bring in whatever values that you want. And something to note here is that what's pretty cool is that recently Batiste launched this new feature where you can bring in inline variable formatting. So if we run this page to give you a sense of what I'm talking about, going to open up with Live Server, you'll notice that it says Hi Satoshi, right? So with inline variable formatting, if that variable is blank, let's save it. And if we rerun this, it'll say hi there. So the reason it does that is because of this logic within inline variable formatting. So if we hop back over to our Typebot and go to that first block, it's kind of like the greeting block, you'll notice that there's this templating here. So if that first name variable is blank, or if it doesn't have any value, then what's going to happen is that it's going to fill in that space with there. Anyways, I thought it was worth mentioning here because it's a new feature and I think it could be used in so many different ways. And then the next thing that we want to do is we want to update the block ID. So in the Typebot docs, there are these console log examples. That is coming directly from the docs. And what we're trying to figure out here is figuring out what your block ID is from your Typebot. So here you can see this is my text string or my block ID. And to find yours, what you would need to do is head over to the page that where we have our example. And if you open up your JavaScript console on Mac, it's a keyboard shortcut of Option Command J, or you can go up to the menu up here under View, Developer, and JavaScript Console. It'll open this up. So here you can see that it displays the block ID right here. So go ahead and copy yours and then head back to your editor and then replace the block ID references like you see right here with your own. And then once you do that, the next thing that you might want to change, and again, this is all depending on how you have your Typebot set up. So once you've updated your block ID, then you can use this out of the box, like without making further changes. Everything should work just fine. If it doesn't, please let me know and then I'll look into it. Now, in your case, you might want to change the Typebot to make it your own. So you might want to change the questions, you might want to change the user input answers, and so forth. Now, in these cases, what you'll need to do is identify the proper block IDs where you want to get certain information. Before I jump into modifying this code, let's talk a little bit more about how this particular code runs. So here you can see three different if statements, the first, second, and third one. And within these if statements, there are two conditions that need to be met in order for the code to be executed. So here is the first condition. The block ID needs to equal this text string, and the answer message needs to include worse, better, or same. So if these two conditions are met, then this function gets triggered where it pulls in the image, right? This is where it just swaps out the background image with this worse image, and so on for this one and this one. But let's say that you want to change it to have the user's input equal something exactly as the user inputs. But let's say that we want to change this condition here. So instead of saying listen or search for the user's message or the user's input to contain worse, let's say that you want it to equal something exactly as you want it. So in this case, let's head back to our Typebot and let's say that we want to trigger an image, but it needs to match this exactly. So before we were just listening to the word better, right? So if that was the case, then whenever the user selects this option or this option, that one image better, the better image will get pulled. But let's say that you want to have an image for each case. So for this option, and so on. So what you can do here is modify the code. And this is the section that you'll want to update. So in this case, this is what I would do. I would just copy this part of the code, and then I would head over to ChatGPT and then ask ChatGPT to please modify my code. All right, with the magic of post-production, I sped this up for you, but here's what we're instructing ChatGPT with. I'm asking it to please modify my code. I'd like to change the following JS condition from answer.message.includes worse to contains exactly much better than I expected. And then I put in this delimiter and put in my code. So let's see what it comes back with. All right, so we got two different solutions here. So the main one looks like is the one that we want. So the main difference here is that this checks for a strict equality. So in other words, it has to match exactly this right here. If we want an other option that's case insensitive, like it mentions here, then we can use this code right here, and it just lowers it converts the string into lowercase. So let's go ahead and use this first option here. And then go back to our code editor and then replace it like so. And to just make sure that it's working properly, what I'm going to do is to just swap it out for the thank you image just to make sure that it works. So let's go ahead and save that and then see what the page looks like. All right, so pressing this should bring the thank you image. Uh-oh, so it looks like it didn't work as expected. So let's head back to the code. And something that you'll notice is that there's a conflict here. So we can see that here it seems like this code was selected to execute rather than this one. So let's go ahead and change this to something else. Let's just put test. So it shouldn't run this code, right? And let's go back to our web page and select the same value. Much better than I expected. Okay. So now we have the thank you page that we were expecting in the background. And then that means that we have to go back to our code and make this a bit more strict, right? Anyways, this is an example of how you can modify the answer message to pull in an image for your background based off of the user input that you're looking for. All right, that's it for this video. I'd love to get your feedback. If you see any sort of issues or conflicts in your code, please let me know. And I'd love to hear about the sorts of projects that you're working on as well. I'm looking forward to hear from you in the comments, and I'll see you in the next video.